Welcome to the Honest Mamas Podcast, where we talk about the emotional and spiritual aspects of the motherhood journey. We are a team of honest mamas, myself, Melissa, Sophie, and Claire. We are psychotherapists, moms, and friends. Join us as we get real about the topics that matter to you. Hi there, everyone, and welcome to episode 43 of the Honest Mamas Podcast. This is Melissa, and today our guest on the show is clinical psychologist Dr. Nazanin Moali. Dr. Moali has a specialty focus in eating disorders, disordered eating, and intuitive eating. She's an eating disorder therapist in Los Angeles and has trained in cutting-edge treatments of eating disorders. And she combines her clinical experience with a passion to support women in repairing their relationship with food. She has supported many to create a long-lasting recovery from destructive behaviors. Here's my conversation with Dr. Moali. Naz, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I'm very excited for our topic today.
Absolutely. And I think so many moms can really identify around body issue things that come up, you know, when you're pregnant, when you're postpartum. And so today's conversation is really going to pinpoint around those women, those mothers that maybe have had some eating challenges, eating issues, body issues, even before becoming pregnant. And so I thought we could just dive right in to how you would define an eating disorder and if there are certain levels. And I'll tell you why, because I think, you know, in my experience of being a woman and having colleagues and being a therapist, there are very clearly defined, oh, if you're doing X, Y, and Z, clearly you have this eating disorder, that eating disorder. But then what I've realized as I've grown up is that there, and worked with clients, there's so many more things in between. So how would you define an eating disorder? Are there other words for it for women that don't maybe fall into a certain category?
Right. I'm glad you mentioned a continuum, because what I see that sometimes people, women and men, they think that unless they meet this certain criteria, they don't have this specific challenges, they don't have the eating disorder. But based on my experience as an eating disorder psychologist, I see that eating disorder challenges, they are in the continuum. And there are a number of different continuum. One is a continuum about how you feel about your body, self-image. One part we have body appreciation, and the other part of the spectrum is body hatred. And it doesn't necessarily mean that, like, you are, if you are somewhere in the, most people there are somewhere in between. So the further you are toward body hatred, that's one of the challenges around that, one of the signs that you're struggling with some body eating disorder, body challenges, disorder eating. The other part is your relationship with the food. And it could be, you might be over controlling what you're eating. So you might be very rigid, which what we see in anorexia, people who are restricting what they're eating, their intake is extremely low. And or the other part is people feel out of control with their eating, which might be they're struggling with binge eating disorders, which they eat like very big portions in a short period of time. And they feel, the most important thing is they feel out of control. Because sometimes people, when I ask them about binge eating, they say, oh, I have a binge eating disorder. But what we talk about it, it seems like they at a certain occasion, we all do overeating, which is okay. It's okay. It might be parties, might be celebrations, different kind of occasion. But with binge eating disorder, it's eating significantly larger portion. Like, for example, I have clients that they eat like several boxes of pizzas in like within 15 minutes, mm-hmm. They feel shameful about it. So it's more about the relationship with the food. And there are, as you mentioned, there are categories. And the other category would be bulimia nervosa, which is people are eating, binging, and then engage in some kind of compensatory behaviors. People do like self-induced vomiting. They might do laxative. They might do over-exercising, which is a more a culturally acceptable way, but again, nonetheless, it can be a purging behavior. And also the other categories would be orthorexia, which is a newer eating disorder, which is a kind of a preoccupation and obsession about healthy eating.
I'm glad you brought that up, Naz, because I think that that one is sort of a newer one to me. And somebody just mentioned it to me not that long ago. And I thought, huh, I think that defines a lot of the women that I've seen in private practice or met in my years.
Absolutely. And I mean, living and practicing in Los Angeles, and I see that there's people constantly talking about healthy food, which is the other part actually of kind of a disorder eating, which could be like putting people, putting food as good and bad, kind of labeling them as a forbidden food and like healthy food. So these categories, as you mentioned, it's a newer eating disorder behavior, is people's obsessions is around eating healthy. And it can be kind of a, the presentation might be like an OCD because people might be at the parties and unless they have certain food and their categories get smaller and smaller. So I have clients at the end, they just have fruits because they cannot eat anything else. And there is no flexibility around their eating, which is, it's important to keep in mind that whatever you're doing, like any other mental health challenges, when it gets in the way of other aspects of your life, for example, for my clients with eating disorders, the restaurants and outing is very challenging. So it's one of the signs that the eating challenges gets into the eating disorder issues. And I'm sorry, you wanted to say something.
Well, I'm curious about, you know, I'm really trying to make this as practical. And there are a lot of different kind of terms out there that, you know, are so helpful to understand. But I think what starts to get tricky is when you feel as a person who may be listening to this, like, I don't do that, but I do this, you know, I don't do that. I don't go as far as maybe throwing up, but I think about my weight every single day, every single moment. There's a preoccupation that comes with it. And I'm just curious from your perspective, Naz, have you found, and because, you know, we speak mostly to women here, we'll just narrow the field to women. Have you found that a lot of women are preoccupied with their weight and how they look? I also know you're in Los Angeles, which my kind of imagination goes to, of course, but I don't know.
Right. No, absolutely. The client that I see, even when they're coming in from to my private practice and they're presenting issues, is not eating disorder. I see this unhealthy relationship with the food. And, you know, as a human being, as women, we're not living in this vacuum. Big part of it is the messages we're getting in the society, in the media, about what is the ideal body. And in reality, there is a huge gap between how women these days, their bodies and the size is, and what the media presents as an ideal. So people looking at this magazine, women, and I'm including as well myself, that like unconsciously you get kind of like triggered that what is that kind of, you come up with this thoughts at, oh, what's wrong with my body? But what we don't kind of think about is these are unrealistic expectations. And we all coming from different backgrounds. And in most cases, unless we engage in this unhealthy kind of eating behaviors, we will not be able to have a fulfilling life and be able to achieve those bodies.
And I also think about that if we steer it now to the mom that is trying to get pregnant or, you know, pregnant or going through IVF and all the hormone changes, the body fluctuations, and then giving birth, and you see in the media, I'm so glad you brought that up because you do see in the media, colleagues of mine, that Sophie and Claire at Honest Mamas, we talk a lot when we see articles and pictures of people in the news that have just had a baby and wow, they've got their six pack of abs back in 3 weeks or 2 weeks, or, you know, look how amazing she looks. She just had a baby a week ago. And that pressure, I mean, when you're a postpartum mom and you are struggling and you're exhausted and your breasts are leaking milk or not, and you are all over the place. And then to see that, that is horrifying to me.
Right. And it fostered this feeling of shame in many of the women I work with, because they feel like they just created this miracle of life. And now they're sitting feeling shameful because they feel, oh my God, I didn't lose 30 pounds within first month, which isn't so unrealistic as far as, you know, our body goes. So I'm glad you mentioned about the talk about the media as well. And the other challenge is during the pregnancy. What I see specifically in clients who had some history of the eating disorder in their past. Actually, one of the main goals that many of the women I work with in my practice, they talk about when they are in the process of recovery, is that they want to become a mother. They want to have their family. So that is a goal that they've been working on for some people, even decades. And then now they're mothers. And I see two different ways that pregnancy and postpartum plays into someone who struggled with eating disorder. One is some people might feel like, you know, they might experience a remission. They kind of get focused on the child. But for some people, it brings up their vulnerability around their weight. And it can trigger their eating disorder behaviors. So I see both part of the challenges. And I see definitely in first trimester is one of the most challenging time for a woman who struggled with the eating disorder behavior, because some of them, they might not be aware that they're pregnant, and they kind of notice this weight gain. It can be very triggering for them. And also all the changes in the hormone that you mentioned that make it very hard for them to cope with the food, because I believe part of the eating disorder it's a coping mechanism for stress, for anxiety, for exhaustion. And when we feel overwhelmed with the stress of being motherhood and pregnancy, for so many people, they kind of lapse back on those behaviors.
Yeah, and I'm glad you brought up the feeling of control, because I think that sometimes, not all the time, but you tell me, I'm imagining that is such an underlay to a lot of these eating challenges is around control.
Absolutely. I see in both part of the spectrum. Earlier, we talked about restriction part, but I see it like people want to over-control their eating because of feeling out of control and many times in their lives. And also the binge eating disorder, I see feeling of out of control around food, which is one of the more common eating disorders that I see in women who are pregnant.
Okay. Yeah, that's really helpful, I think. And also to mention, as you said, the first trimester can be very challenging or tricky. So what do you suggest with women that may be listening who have maybe had some eating challenges or eating disorder history that are, you know, maybe in their first trimester or, you know, planning on getting pregnant? What do you think might help these women, or even women that just aren't happy with their bodies and think about it every day? You know, what would help these women as they're preparing to get pregnant if they're struggling in this way?
One important thing that I always encourage my clients is that talking about, instead of acting out on those eating disorder behaviors, talk about it. Find a therapist and kind of like, because with feeling of shame, that can trigger the eating disorder behavior. And one other thing is that tell your partner about your challenges, because I know with eating disorder, many of my clients, they never told their partner. Sometimes they are in remission. Sometimes they felt like embarrassed to talk about it. But talking about your challenge with your partner is so important for eliciting support, because this is going to be a tough journey and you would need that support. So that would be the very important step that I highly recommend. The other thing is, if you are in the midst of eating disorder challenges, find the eating disorder therapist and a team that they can help you through this journey. It doesn't mean that you're not going to be able to have a child, but they're going to help you. They're going to keep you accountable. They're going to give you tools so you would be able to go through this journey with not necessarily experiencing like all this ups and downs around the eating disorder. So getting support, I think, is very important.
Yes. And as you're even talking, I'm thinking about all the different messages that we hear, all the different diets, all the different plans, all the different ways to eat food, cook food, what food choices to have, what to avoid. Ears and our minds and our hearts and our psyches are saturated with different messages of what's quote good and what is, quote, bad. So I'm thinking about the mom that is getting pregnant and it's her first trimester and she's been able maybe to handle, or maybe her eating disorder is in remission, as you say, or, you know, she's gotten to a point in her life where she's like, okay, I kind of like where my body's at. And then she wants to have a baby, and how this can trigger up so many of the past, you know, issues, as you're saying. And I'm so curious about the part you said about shame and how that triggers some of the eating disorders. Can you say a little bit more about that?
Absolutely. The eating disorder is the disorder that, like, people kind of struggle most of the time alone. And they feel they're alone in it because they don't talk about it. They engage in these behaviors alone. And feeling shameful, it can be a trigger. And it's part of it is coming from feeling defective. People thinking about, I have this dark secret and I'm broken and I'm not fixable. And they feel that if they show this part of themselves to other people, they might not be accepted. And I, based on my experience, sometimes when we're sharing this vulnerabilities with people, obviously they're safe, we can trust, they can help us through this and it can bring us closer, specifically with our partners. Because I feel, again, struggling alone can make things worse. And the other piece is about the shame is for people who are bigger sizes, coming from a bigger, have bigger genes, is that people kind of constantly getting bombarded about negative messages around their weight. For example, I have clients that they're going in for, I don't know, like a routine medical procedure, and all they're hearing is that you got to lose weight. Sometimes they're going in because their presenting problem is not that has nothing to do with their weight, but they're constantly hearing this message that having this kind of body is not acceptable, which kind of can be very stressful, and it can increase it. Like there were studies looking into cortisol and how we're hearing this, we get cortisol, hormone of cortisol, and that triggers binge eating. So it's so not helpful.
Absolutely. And I'm even thinking for the moms that go in, I mean, I'm a mom of two. I can absolutely relate going into her checkup, you know, whether she's a couple weeks pregnant or in the first trimester and so on. And we're talking about how it's so challenging as a woman to feel as if your body is expanding, it's growing, and it's supposed to. And I think a lot of women embrace that. You know, great, for the first time in my life, I can let my stomach hang out. I mean, I know that was me. I loved going to the beach pregnant because I didn't have to worry. I was like, let it hang out. It's all there for everyone to see. I actually feel really beautiful. And for some other women, it feels not beautiful to them at all. And I'm just thinking about, you know, as we go in for checkups and things like that, you know, going through pregnancy, there is a lot of talk about gestational diabetes. There's a lot of talk about if you gain too much weight, then your baby will be too big and then you won't be able to have a natural vaginal birth. And I'm just wondering, in your experience, what you think these messages, and I understand, you know, science and medicine certainly have a place, but for a woman's psyche and emotional well-being, what do you think this does for a mom?
You know, what's interesting is that you're absolutely right on telling that, like, this is like, for some women, all throughout their lives, it's been a constant message that your body is not okay. And now they're going, they're excited about having pregnancy and creating this life. And then all they're hearing is that, you know, you got to lose weight. There might be some complications. And I understand, I work with people in medical field and I know, I understand their perspective, but, you know, presenting this in this way is so not helpful because as we were talking about earlier, that this feeling of shame that actually can trigger binge eating because that's on how our body works. Because when you're feeling shameful and stressed out, for many people, they cope with food. So it's very important to kind of focus on health, not necessarily weight. Because what's important is you and the baby will be healthy. And with making healthy choices, sometimes I see the weight challenges also get resolved. So it's very important for us also to accept that all kind of bodies are beautiful and acceptable. And there's no wrong way of having a body.
Yes. And I think for me, it's actually triggering a memory as we talk. For me, when I first went in with my first child, I remember asking my doctor to make a note. I would get on the scale, I would look away, and I would say, just make a note of my weight, do whatever you need to do. But I don't want to know, because I know myself. And I know that if I focus too much on the weight, I lose touch with how, on the number, I lose touch with how I feel. And so some practical tips that helped me was just really telling them, unless it's a problem, don't tell me my weight. I really don't want to know. And then I also chose clothes that fit me well, that I felt good in. And, you know, that moment at the beach was also kind of a celebratory moment for me, where I could wear a bikini and I could just let everything hang out. And there, for me, there was just more permission to kind of be in my body, because this was a little bit more socially acceptable to grow a baby. And this is what happens, and your body changes. And, you know, I think for a lot of women, they have that experience, or they have the other complete experience. No, I have to be fit and trim and muscular and fit into a certain, you know, category, even when pregnant.
Right. And it's just how that can steal the joy from the pregnancy, being preoccupied with your weight and kind of having this unrealistic expectation from your body that's creating another life.
Right. Right. I think we forget that sometimes. Like some pregnant moms that I know are like, oh my gosh, I'm so tired, it's so weird. And I'm like, you have to remember that you are growing a human inside your body. Like, that is a miracle. That's amazing what it takes to do that.
Yeah. And I think what can be a wonderful strategy for many women, I know mothers are like, you know, they're very instinctively, they're very excited about this process. So for example, my clients, they're struggling with anorexia, giving them education about, like, you know, how the baby development of fetus and all of that can be very encouraging for them to continue in the path of recovery. Because sometimes, as you mentioned, that we hear this like negative messages around our body and we disconnect from the fact that what's going on inside us. And that can be very dangerous.
You brought up another really good practical point. You know, number one, it sounds like talking to somebody about some of the challenges that you're facing, whether you have an eating challenge or disorder in the past. And then you also bring up such another good point around really staying connected to your body and what's actually happening with the fetus inside, and what your body is actually doing that it knows how to do. That's another way to stay sort of grounded and connected to what's happening in the moment versus spinning off into a fantasy or a narrative of what you should be.
Absolutely. And again, kind of focusing, as you said, tuning in with the emotions and all of those like changes in the body and the impact on the fetus can be very grounding for many women.
Yes. And so if we fast forward, and I'll open this little segment with a personal share around after I gave birth, I had heard that breastfeeding, your weight will just fly off. And isn't it amazing? Breastfeeding for weight loss. Isn't it incredible? And for me, it was such a struggle. It's almost like I breastfed and my body held on to weight to feed the baby. Mm-hmm. And I was in a community of women that I had gone through the birth education classes with, and we all came back together after the baby was born. And a lot of the women had lost weight and they were feeling so good in their bodies and so confident. And oh yeah, I was breastfeeding. I did nothing else. And for me, I was miserable in my body. I hadn't lost a thing. If anything, I had gained a few pounds. And so I just want to know, from your perspective, the postpartum body, what can you say about that?
I think you brought up such an excellent point, because many people have unrealistic expectation. We all have different bodies. Not like you had an unrealistic expectation, but I see it all the time that because of what people see in the media, they think, oh, I got to lose weight in like first month. Mm-hmm. And you know, it could be possible, but what is the cost of it for you? Because, you know, sometimes we kind of forget that with the celebrities, with this, like different people we see in TV and radio, they have the reality of their lives might be very different than ours in the fact that they have a chef and the cook that they cook for them, and they have this team that take care of the baby. And we are kind of exhausted throughout the first month of like with postpartum. And for many women, sometimes they struggle with depression and anxiety as part of natural part of postpartum mental health, and that can trigger the eating challenges. So first thing is just kind of think about what is realistic for my body. And we all have different kind of body. And the other thing is just, it's good that you were part of that group. And, you know, sometimes I feel as women, we need to have each other's back. Because I see it all the time that people might kind of engage in different kind of weight loss. And they're not necessarily kind of forthcoming with each other. So they say, oh, that's all I did. Like, but it's possible they had a number of different kind of ways for losing weight or different strategies. So I kind of being honest with each other is important. And actually, I prefer when people have a slower pace in losing weight, because I feel if the weight loss is rapid following and during postpartum, that can be triggering for eating disorder.
Yes. And I think that what I want to just make sure is clear is that finding the community of others that you don't feel judged by, you don't feel as if it's a comparison game. And I know those listening know those people in your life that when you get around, you just start feeling not good about yourself. You start comparing, well, look what they've done, blah, blah, blah. And it's not an open dialogue. So I really, what helped me also is not spending time with those people in that very vulnerable first couple months postpartum, where you're exhausted, you're hormonal, you are sleep deprived. And then you have to deal with, oh, look at, you know, Susie Q. Doesn't she look amazing? And she's sporting this new outfit and she's so out in the open about her weight loss. And she's just really, it was too much for me, to be honest with you, Naz. It was too much for me at that time. And so I decided, you know what? I'm not going to spend as much time with that person right now. I'm really just going to focus on the people that just allow me maybe to talk openly about my struggle and how I am feeling in my body. And even if they, in my mind, look better than me, I think there's a different way of relating. You know, when you feel so triggered around certain people in those early months, I encourage you to maybe just take some space from them if you can.
What a great recommendation, because I feel when we are vulnerable and, you know, there's so many things going on postpartum with our hormones, with changes in lifestyle, with our like level of exhaustion, that it's going to be more challenging to kind of, we need to kind of restore our energy to taking care of ourselves and like doing activities that makes us feel better about ourselves instead of kind of putting ourselves in a place that kind of is stressful and getting exposed to the things that just kind of doesn't add to our mental health and mental wellness. And I think one of the things that I highly recommend for women in postpartum, A, be aware of the postpartum mental health challenges. And I see that people kind of struggling with shame, and I'm sure you had episodes on that, with depression, anxiety, eating disorder, and they kind of feel shameful because they see, you know, I had this baby, why I'm feeling this way? So kind of have awareness and also increasing your support.
Yes.
Whatever you mentioned, that being around people that gives you good energy, makes you feel better. And there are different professional groups, like for eating disorder recovery, for new moms and for weight loss kind of things. So depending on what is a good fit for you, create this program that gives you helps you to regain your emotional wellness if that's a challenge for you.
Absolutely. Because I do think that it goes so much so, the last thing I'll say is that it goes so much with shame. You know, when we're feeling ashamed, it's such a hidden secret almost. It feels dark. It feels hidden. And if we can be more open, I feel, and I'm sure you'll resonate with this, Naz, is that it just doesn't have that much power over you anymore.
Right. And I think just one of the best strategies for shame resiliency is just putting it out there and sharing it in a safe group. And that can be very transformative. And seeing that's the experience of many other people around us. So we're not alone in this struggle.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And the last thing I would say is that, you know, I know Brené Brown does so much work around shame.
I love her.
Me too. And her, you know, her coming out and talking about this and about courage is just incredible work. So if you haven't heard about her, we'll have it in the show notes. She has some incredible TED Talks and books and things like that. But so if people want to get in touch with you, Naz, how do they do that?
So you can check out my private practice website, which is oasis2cure.com. I have my contact information there, but I have lots of blogs on eating disorder, how to cope with different eating disorders. So that can be a resource as well. And they can also check out my podcast website, which is sexologypodcast.com.
Wonderful. We'll have all of that in the show notes. Thanks so much for joining me today.
Thank you for having me. This was wonderful.
Thank you so much for joining me today. And if you like this podcast, don't forget to subscribe, rate, and review. To get our show notes, go to www.honestmamas.com/episode-43 and sign up for our Honest Mamas e-course at honestmamas.com. You can also join our community on Facebook by going to facebook.com/honestmamascommunity, where these conversations and way more will continue.